And Kerry is the founding director of the Singapore Earth Observatory, which is the biggest observatory of its kind in Southeast Asia, if I'm correct. He's also an internationally renowned expert on some of the most disrupting events on our planet, namely earthquakes. I first got to know what kind of man Kerry is when I asked him to be a speaker at our 2012 conference, More is Different. I'm honored, he said, but I have been exposed to such intellectual challenges innumerable times. The young scientists in my institute have not. And I would suggest you invite one of them to give the talk, to be exposed and have a great learning experience. He then suggested I invite a young researcher, Emma Hill, an NRF fellow, who subsequently gave a superb presentation that people who heard her speak still talk about. That is who Kerry is, a great leader in science, somebody who puts his people first and who fights for his institute. When I asked him about 9 months ago, invited him to speak today, he agreed almost immediately, but he said, only if I can make my own pitch. What that pitch is going to be, we will hear from him now. Please join me in welcoming Kerry.
Jan is very smart. He asks you to give a talk about a year before you have to give it, and so, of course, then it's very easy to say yes. Now, a couple days ago when I thought, what have I done? I've just committed 3 days of my life here. But it sounds very promising, and I've already learned a lot from the first two speakers. When you look at this image of the Earth, everything you see here is a result of disruption, right? The clouds moving around, causing storms, plate tectonics separating Saudi Arabia from Iran, and India colliding with Asia, and so on. And you can't see the volcanoes at this scale, but pretty much as Earthlings, we're unlike Martians. Martians, if they exist, must be very boring because they've never had to deal with a disruptive planet. But we, in fact, have. And as an Earth scientist, part of my job is to help my fellow citizens, my fellow Earthlings, understand that things are not quite as benign on this planet as we might think. At the rate with which we metabolize, where we go through one day at a time, 1 hour and a half long talk at a time, we don't see things happening that actually could have profound impact on us and on our societies over the next century, millennium, or longer. And what I want to talk to you about today is what I call the low likelihood, high risk hurdle that we face. And I'll use examples from my own expertise, geohazards, to illustrate those. And I guess the point I want to get across, a couple of points I want to get across are, if I can figure out how to use this thing. The bottom one first, is it? No? Let's see, it was working when we tried it out. Okay, you try. See, I told you. Tell you what, I can do it this way probably. There we go, I'll just use this. All right, so one point which should be pretty obvious, but I'm going to spend about 5 or so slides showing it to you. Humans usually deal very well with frequent hazards. Okay? We don't deal well with infrequent ones. Science can provide an impetus for us to reduce our geohazards risk, which tend to be infrequent hazards at any one place. And then at the end, I'm going to give you a couple of examples from the Earth Observatory of what we're actually doing to go the last mile, to leave the scientific aspects and to try to get something to really happen in a community. Here's a picture I took off the web from Bangkok. I gave a talk in Bangkok a couple days ago similar to this. We know that there are dangers on the road, and we know, now it works. Okay, now which one is the pointer? Is it that one? Yeah, okay. So we know that if we turn off of the road here and go that way, it's not going to be good for us. We know that if we don't make a turn the right lane, going the right direction, we're going to get hit, we're going to get hurt, somebody else is going to be hurt, and so on. So we train ourselves to be ordered in our society. We have certain rules we obey because we know that our welfare and our fellow citizens' welfare depends very much on it. So it's obvious that these sorts of issues we have to deal with if we want to survive from day to day. If we want to have evolutionary fitness, as they say, if we want to have children, we have to basically obey some rules to survive hazards that exist with us and around us every single day. I went the wrong way again. Here's an example of my own. I had a nice house in the mountains of east of Los Angeles here, and one day when I was in Taiwan sitting on an advisory panel, I got a call saying that my house was probably burnt down. And there had not been a fire on this part of the mountain since 1922. So you might think that I wouldn't have done anything about fire hazard. But in fact, the forest department, the fire department, requires you to clear the brush from underneath these trees so that the fire, if it does come, can't go up into the canopy and rage right through and burn up your house. So I had done that. I had insurance, and the fire came through. It took me 2 weeks to figure out that my house was still there, but it was still there. So in aggregate on the mountain, there's a fire every 5 or 10 years, a big damaging fire. But because of that aggregated experience, we have to have insurance. We have to listen to the fire department. If we don't, we get fined. So here's another example of a hazard that is common, not at any one place, but in aggregate, it's very common. And so there are ways we in society deal with it, and we recognize the need to, and we're pretty smart about these things. I should say most of my neighbors didn't make it in this case. Here's an example that's a little more difficult. This is the part of the Big Island of Hawaii. It's Kilauea Volcano. And, doggone it. All right, so over here, you see, here's Kilauea Caldera. And you see here flows in place between 1790 and 1982, all the ones in this horizontal crosshatch. Okay. These crosshatches are cities or towns, developments, they're roads. And you can see that for the most part, where the flows happened in the 1970s, there are no homes. That's because there were flows happening then during a time of development of this part of Hawaii, and nobody was dumb enough to build a house here. This little flow right here is one that inspired me to become a geologist, actually. I remember National Geographic, 1959, the beautiful fire fountains of Mauna'ulu. Well, there hadn't been a flow here for quite some time, and so folks built down here at Royal Garden Subdivision. And in 1984, eruptions began here that continue today. And basically, all of this flank now is covered with young lava. And in fact, this subdivision made a gamble and lost. But for the most part, this part of the volcano is very sparsely populated because basically is the goddess that lives with and causes the lava flows in Hawaii. And so for the most part, this is undeveloped, as well it should be. Later on, we'll come back to it. So that's a hazard that happens frequently enough that it's in people's memory. Same generation, one generation ago, maybe two generations ago. And people are smart enough. There's something in their evolutionary makeup that tells them that if I want to have children and have a future, people have a future here, I shouldn't probably build here. So here's an example of where people have, for the most part, made the right decision, but in some cases did not. Now later on, we'll come back to these little features here, which are actually faults, and we'll talk about a hazard that is so infrequent that nobody worries about it. Yogyakarta is an interesting example of where things happen frequently enough that there are zones for Mount Merapi here, which you can see puffing away one day a few years ago. Here's Borobudur, the biggest Buddhist temple in the world. And Borobudur, actually, you might not be able to see it from here, but it's actually on the flanks of the volcano. The flanks get smoother and shallower and shallower as they come down toward Borobudur. But in history, at least in written history, there's no case of where a flow actually came down as far as Borobudur or as far as the town of Yogyakarta. Now, here's a flow that came down. You can see it from satellite infrared imagery. Here's a flow that came down this far. It had never come down, flows had never come down that far on the flanks of Mount Merapi in the 150 years of historical record. That was unfortunate because the zoning for not building, the hazard zones around Merapi are based upon the historical record, only going back to 1865. So this one actually killed a bunch of people right down in here because it went actually past what had been known from several generations of people living in the area. Now note, I will come back to this in a little bit, but note that Yogyakarta here actually also exists on the flatter, shallower flanks, like Borobudur, of this volcano, but never in the last 1,000 years has a flow reached as far as Yogyakarta. So Yogyakarta builds blissfully, taking no heed to the fact that it sits on the flank of a volcano. Another example of where communities, countries have done a good job with their geohazards is here. These are, someday I'll learn. This is actually a fault that broke in 1999. And here are buildings built right next to and in some cases even on the fault. And you can see that with only a couple of exceptions, there were no collapses. That's not because shaking here occurs very often. This is the strongest shaking ever experienced historically at this particular spot in central western Taiwan. But Taiwan, as an aggregate, has strong shaking so often that they have among the strongest building codes and among the strongest enforcement of those building codes anywhere on Earth. So that's why these buildings stood. Now later we'll talk about what they do about building on faults. You can see this building actually moved into the street because it was on top of the fault and the fault moved it this way. And the force was so great that all the contents came out the windows and landed on the road. But unless you've been with those contents, you probably survived in that building. Wrong direction again. All right. So those are examples of where people have hazards happening often enough, either at their particular site or in aggregate among their community, among their country, that they do something rational about it, and in fact, they build resilience into their communities in the face of eruptions, in the face of earthquake hazards, in the cases I've just shown you. Let's talk now about a few that are so infrequent that we simply don't pay any attention to them. Let's go back to this same slide again. That building was built so strong that even though its foundations were rent asunder by about 5 meters of shortening, the building simply got picked up and moved out into the street, and it didn't collapse. Pretty amazing testament to seismic over-engineering. But the building owner wasn't particularly happy from a financial point of view because the building was a total loss. It now tilts several degrees toward that street. And in fact, here's a building that actually collapsed because it was on the fault. And in Taiwan, they make the choice that because faulting has so seldom itself actually caused disruption, caused damage or loss of life, they simply choose to ignore earthquake faulting as a significant problem. Very few times in Taiwanese history has a fault rupture itself actually destroyed property or killed people. They still don't worry about the earthquake fault so much, okay? They feel their property is too valuable, and in fact, they don't want to. They'll just live with the losses, and as this lot becomes much shorter, the owner will simply live with that. He's just lost 10 meters of property. Oops, I did it wrong again. Next time, I'm going to get it right. All right, so as I said before, Yogyakarta has been built on the distal parts of the Merapi volcano. About 1,000 or 1,200 years ago, there's a legend that in fact the kingdom that was established here moved, and it moved all the way over towards Surabaya. And nobody knows exactly why that was, but in all probability, there was a large eruption that basically covered the flank of the volcano on this side, and it caused a massive disruption to the society at the time. This is the center of Java at the time, culturally. And they all ended up moving over towards Surabaya. So there's an example of how we just don't worry about things that are a millennium in the offing. Things that'll happen in 100 years, 200 years, a millennium or longer, we tend to just have no desire to deal with, for reasons that Peter alluded to. You know, we worry about election cycles or mortgage cycles, or as far as we can see in the future is maybe 50 years. Did I do it again? I did it again. All right. Here's something even bigger, third example. There's Singapore over here on the right for scale, 45 kilometers by about 25. Here's the Big Island of Hawaii, and I just showed you Kilauea volcano here. Let me show you a beautiful piece of Molokai. Molokai is, the north side of Molokai is just one enormous escarpment. You can see the layers of lava here that formed millions of years ago, and this big escarpment is an indication that, in fact, this part of Molokai slid off into the ocean some time ago, some million or half million or 750,000 years ago. The same thing is true of Oahu on both sides, Kauai, Lanai, Maui, Big Island of Hawaii. As recently as 100,000 years ago, a big chunk of Hawaii went sliding off into the ocean. And when that happens, it moves out at maybe 100 meters per second. The big chunk of the volcano slides away, and it displaces water. And when you displace water quickly, what do? You produce dead fish? Yeah, tsunami. Okay, tsunami. All right, so the tsunamis that were generated from this were enormous, beyond anything that we've ever experienced in civilization in the last 10,000 years. All right, which one is it? It's this one. Nope, this one. Peter, how did you do this? You're so smart. Okay, so maybe you use this. That's what I'm going to do. Okay, so here's a image that a colleague of mine at University of California, Santa Cruz put together a number of years ago, and it shows for every hour what the tsunami radiating out from this collapse of this piece of Hawaii would look like. So here we are at 1 hour out, here at 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 hours. So 6 hours from the time of the collapse, we're arriving in Quito, Ecuador. All right, and then Peru over here, and over here in New Guinea and Australia. The numbers here, mostly negatives, they mostly show the elevation of the trough of the tsunami as it passes through the ocean in deep water. I don't know why he didn't show the crests, but basically the troughs and crests are going to be about the same height. You can see that basically 10 meters, 11 meters, 19, 30, something like 25 along the Pacific West Coast, and so on, and similar numbers over here. So imagine now something that probably happens in the Pacific Ocean about every few tens of thousands of years, so once every civilization or so. You have a tsunami that is trans-Pacific like this, and it's far bigger than anything that is generated just by the subduction zones here, or by the subduction zone here that broke a few weeks ago, or along the Japanese coast or Alaskan coast. So this is something that we have never had in our memory as human beings. If they happen every 50,000 or 100,000 years, that means only 3 or 4 times since Homo sapiens evolved to be Homo sapiens a couple hundred thousand years ago. So I ask you a question, should we worry about these? Very, very, very low likelihood, but very, very serious consequences. I would imagine that the answers are going to be all over the place in this room if I asked, right? We should worry about it. Those who are Singaporeans who are 110% want to have 110% security say, yes, we probably should worry about this. Americans, we can survive. I remember being very impressed by your Prime Minister Lee Hsien Loong a few years ago when he was talking to Charlie Rose. He was in New York for a nuclear security conference, and Charlie Rose asked to interview him, and Rose at one point said, Prime Minister, Singapore has a reputation for being very, very conservative, and Lee Hsien Loong said, yes, but you have to understand the difference between your country and mine. You're a very big country separated by very big oceans. You can afford to make very big mistakes. And in fact, you have. We can't afford to make a single big mistake, or we're over. Okay, let's try it. Yes. All right. finally. All right, so Roland, here's what I was telling you I was going to show you. This is an ice core record, I think, from Antarctica. And Antarctic records of sulfate are actually important because when you have tropical eruptions, the sulfate goes into the atmosphere both in the north and the south, and you get a global effect, which you don't get if you have an eruption, say, from Iceland, like this. Oops, wrong one. Like this one. Okay, I show three here because these three had big climate influences. Tambora basically had about 10 years of effect, starting with the year without a summer, the year that Mary Shelley wrote Frankenstein while she was having a miserable experience in Geneva with clouds and rain all summer. And that led to famines in Bangladesh, which in fact led to epidemics, which basically spread worldwide by 1818, 1820 or so. So Tambora was basically an eruption that came out of eastern Indonesia, Lombok, Samalas volcano, and had a global effect on climate. And mass starvations in the American Northeast. It led to a Western expansion into Ohio and Indiana at the time. Iceland actually happened just before the French Revolution. It was part of the problem in terms of food security in Europe. Lombok, pardon me, this is the one of Lombok. This is Tambora, came out of Sumbawa, Indonesia, and right next door, Lombok, in about 1257. When I shared this with Roland Fletcher about a year ago or so, he said, "My goodness, that's when we had really, really serious disruptions in Angkor," which maybe he'll talk about later. So these are things that happen not very frequently. They happen every 300 years or so on average. There's a big enough eruption that we have big problems in food security and big global climatic effects. So we tend not to think about them. For example, we don't know which volcanoes of the 200 or 300 in Indonesia, we don't know which ones are capable of doing this, of having eruptions like this. We don't even know which ones are the potential culprits that could in fact cause big food security issues for Singapore, for China, for the United States. Don't even know which ones they are. Haven't even identified these guys. And why? Well, there's never been a systematic program to plumb the depths of those volcanoes to see which ones have big magma chambers beneath them. Why? Well, that's an academic problem. Well, it's an academic problem that within a matter of a half year or a year could become a very, very real problem for much of the world. All right, let me give you a couple of examples where we're actually doing something to help people understand these hazards and to understand their probabilities and so on and so forth. And I'll use examples just from earthquakes, because I'm most familiar with them. And I'll start with what I actually had just wrapped up when I first came to Singapore about 8 years ago. We actually use corals as seismographs. We can actually see evidence of tsunamis and earthquakes in corals. And here we are along the west coast of Sumatra, and you can see the scale here is about 100 kilometers, so we're looking at about 400 kilometer length here. This is the part of the big megathrust fault going down from the Indian Ocean under Sumatra that's closest to Singapore. And as you'll see, you'll see later. In 1350, there was a big earthquake, probably a magnitude 8.5 or so. 30 years later, plus or minus, there was another one. Then everything went quiet. Anybody who lived there between 1380 and about 1600 probably didn't experience big earthquakes. Then in 1597, there was another magnitude 8.5 or 9, followed just 14 or 15 or 20 years later by another one. Followed a few years later, a few decades later, by another one. Followed a few decades later by another one. And then maybe 45 or so years later, still another one. So a cluster of two within about 30 years, a cluster of five within 100 years, and then quiescence. And then 1797, another one. And then 35 years later, another one. So there's clusters here we've discovered. One, two, three. 14th century, 17th century, 18th century, and things have been very, very quiet again until 2007. 2007, there was a magnitude 8.4 earthquake, and I would venture to say that this is what's next. And those of us sitting, working, or living in high rises in Singapore are going to feel that earthquake as a gentle swaying. Singapore probably will not have significant damage from this earthquake, this magnitude 9, because it's 600 kilometers away. So what has this science led to? Prior to this work being done, nobody knew on the west coast of Sumatra that in fact they might have a big earthquake in their future, a damaging tsunami. Now the city of Padang knows that they do. Here's a model from a German colleagues as to what the tsunami might look like a few minutes after, half an hour after the earthquake. So here we are 4 minutes in, here we are 7 minutes in, here we are 10 minutes in. The blue area represents about half of the city of 800,000 people. And very, very little has been done in the 10 years or so since this was known to secure their safety. Very little has been done in the way of changing building codes so that they won't collapse into the street. Very little has been done to widen the street so that people can get out. There is some signage that shows where to go, you know, upstream and so on. But there are probably about 400,000 people here at risk. And even though we've done the science, I would say that the last mile is only about 10 meters run so far. So here's an example to me of where we've done a lot of good science, but in fact it's just not getting much traction. And why is that? It's because I think we worry more about looking to the right or to the left when we cross the street, teaching our children to worry about other types of short-term hazards. And even though this is almost certain to happen within the next 30 or 40 years, it's just too long of a time span for us to, for this community to worry about. My guess is if this were Singapore, things would have been done to ensure people's safety and safety of property and so on. Example two, after the 2004 Indian Ocean tsunami, billions of dollars were spent to what they called Build Back Better. Okay, they wanted to build back Banda Aceh and the surrounding communities that were devastated by the tsunami. They wanted to build it back better. And the problem with building back better is if you don't know whether something similar or bigger or smaller could hit you again within the next 50 or 100 years, how do you know you've done it better? It turns out what happened is that that now there are more poor people living near the coast, and the people who could afford it have purchased property further inland and are living further inland outside of the 2004 tsunami zone. Now, whether that's okay, I'll try to show you in a few seconds here. Charlie Rubin, who's in the audience over here. Charlie, raise your hand. There he goes. Charlie actually led a study that we have been doing for the last few years in a cave. There's Charlie sitting there, standing there like professors are supposed to, just watching while students, I think that's actually me down there digging. Yeah. And these are our local collaborators and fellow and diggers and so on. And here's our lightsabers. And so here we are in this big cave, and the cave is right at sea level, just barely above sea level. So when tsunamis come in, they hit the open cave, the 10-meter hole in the cave, and they bring in all this sand. And depending on how long the water stays in, how big the tsunami is, more and more sand settles out. So we are digging up the sand here. There's a pile of it there, and we have this beautiful record that shows 8,000 years of tsunamis. So from here to here, 8,000 years. This is the 2004 deposit. Here's a deposit about 5,000 years ago, and 11 or so deposits in 8,000 years. So here's the figure that Charlie's used to summarize the whole thing. Here's the thickness of the sand, each tsunami sand A through K, not 2004 shown here, and here are the radiocarbon dates. So from 3,000 years ago back to about 7,500 years ago, there's a gap here between 3,000 and 2004. For reasons I won't go into, but you can see that the closer these are together, the shorter the period between earthquakes. This is just statistics of the date. So you can see that the earthquakes are on the order of a few hundred years apart here, but getting closer. The tsunamis are getting closer and closer and closer as we go from 7,500 to 5,000. Then there's a 2,000-year gap where there's nothing in there. No tsunami for 2,000 years. If that's where we are right now, they did indeed bid back better. Okay, and they'll be safe now for 2,000 years. But here, following that 2,000-year gap, there were four tsunamis all within about 100 years. So what have we taught people here in this case? We've taught them that tsunamis may average 400 years apart, but sometimes they're very closely spaced, and sometimes they're very far, spaced very far apart. So probably, if you want to be cautious, if you want to be careful and ensure your society will be safe for the next century or so, probably you would wanted to have not built back better immediately on the coast. But these sorts of data would be available to you as your community discusses what it wants to do, what level of security and safety it wants to spend money on. Does it want to keep that corridor along the coast totally free of building for 100 years, or are you willing to take the risk since the average is 400? Science can actually give you the data with which to have a conversation. We wouldn't presume to say what you should do with it. We just finished mapping Burma and mapping Bangladesh. Believe it or not, there had not been a modern map of the earthquake faults of Bangladesh or Burma. And yet Dhaka, a city where buildings fall down without earthquakes, right, is only a few tens of kilometers away from the B in Burma on that map. So here's Dhaka. This is one of the bigger earthquake faults on Earth. And it comes up, it covers the eastern half of Bangladesh. Now, Peter mentioned that Bangladesh has a problem with about half of the country being very close to sea level and at risk of sea level encroachment over the next century or so. Nobody actually knows when the last big earthquake was on that big hidden fault that goes from, that covers basically the entire ground underneath the words Burma and plate. When that happens, though, it'll probably be about a magnitude 9. And it will probably affect all three of the major cities in Bangladesh. And it's not hard to imagine that there could be a loss measured not in the tens of thousands, not in the hundreds of thousands, but in the millions. Okay, Dhaka is what, 15 million people. So what do we do about those sorts of problems? The scientists tell you that this can happen. We don't yet know how often. We don't have an example going back a few hundred years, so nobody thinks about it. Bangladesh has lots of other problems besides these, including the climate, the sea level problem, but what does it do about this? I would say that unless you have an effective government, you can't do much about it. And unless you have people who have time to think about these sorts of long-term, very unlikely, but very high-consequence events, you simply won't think about it. All right, I'm finally getting the hang of it. All right, so one thing we can do once we have that map of the earthquake faults is we can actually make calculations. We know about how fast the faults are slipping. Some are fast, some are slow. Some produce big earthquakes, some produce small ones. We can actually produce hazard maps, and this is an example of two probabilistic seismic hazard maps, PSHAs. And you can see that where the colors are hottest is where you have the most likelihood in any one place to have a strong earthquake. And in this case, the strongest possibilities are along this big fault that goes right through the capital, the new capital of Myanmar, Naypyidaw. Now, Naypyidaw was built for political reasons. The military wanted to move up here to here away from Yangon, where all the population was. They had no idea that they were building right on their equivalent of a San Andreas fault. Naypyidaw is actually straddles this big structure. And it just so happens that this particular piece of the fault from Naypyidaw up to about here had a magnitude 8 about 160, 170 years ago. Nobody yet knows how often these happen. But when it does, it'll be a big earthquake. Now, it's interesting. You might think, well, this would be a dangerous place to live. It is a dangerous place to live, but in fact, the blue area that has the lower likelihoods is more likely to have a big earthquake than the red area. And the reason is that the blue area, although it had any one spot has a lower probability, there's more of it. So most likely when you hear about the next earthquake in Myanmar or northern Thailand or northern Laos, it'll be somewhere in this area, a fault that might have one chance in 500 years of breaking. But there are so many more faults that, in fact, together they pose a bigger hazard. So that just illustrates that. You can have one spot with a 10% probability in, say, 100 years, 11 spots with 1% probability, and in fact, you're more likely to have the next earthquake here, right, in one of those spots. I'll just go back to basically to the Pleistocene here. This is work I did when I was a PhD student back in the Pleistocene. And here you see a record of sediments, about 2,000 years of sediment in a river. And you can see, and there's evidence for an earthquake here, about 800 AD, 1100 AD, 1200, 1550, 1857. There's been 40 years of modern science done on the San Andreas Fault in California. And it's taken that long, it's taken 40 years of building up various aspects of earthquake science to produce what people really need in Southern California to understand how to deal with their hazards. Here's a summary of what we know from our paleoseismic work. We know there were these are all the same map, same part of Southern California. There's Los Angeles, there's Pasadena, San Bernardino, San Francisco would be up here, Mexican border down here. And what each of these are earthquakes plus or minus 25, 30 years, going through from 950 AD, 1050, 1100, 12, 1350, all the way to 1857, our last big one. And what you can notice is that they tend to start in the south again, and then go north, south, north, south, middle, north. So based upon that 1,500 years of history, we began to put together a project a few years ago called the Shakeout, and based upon the idea that, in fact, the next earthquake would be in the south. So here you have Southern California tilted on its side, and here's a model that shows the rupture beginning in the south, and it's proceeding along this red line. Red means really strong shaking, strong enough that you couldn't walk. Here's the first waves coming out, very strong. Here's Palm Springs. Here's the way the rupture coming continuing along. Here's the seconds. We're 23 seconds into the earthquake. So this model has been run as a scenario earthquake for Los Angeles and for Southern California. And based upon this quantitative model and others, we now know, we can see how resilient our police forces are, our phone lines are, our utilities are, and so on. And we can see how the shaking is different from place to place. Unless 40 years of science had been done, this would have been basically impossible. Now, I want to skip ahead a little bit here in the interest of time, if I can figure out there we go. Oops. All right, let's go see what happens in L.A. here. So we're coming into L.A. Notice that this is the most populated part of the Los Angeles, the Southern California region. And notice that the waves coming into the valleys actually stay strong. Most of the strong shaking is along the fault, but when you go into valleys full of sediment, they shake stronger and longer than they do in the mountains. So LA now, we know, has a very serious problem from a San Andreas Fault rupture, even though it's 50 kilometers away from the nearest part of Los Angeles Basin. It just keeps ringing and ringing and ringing for a long, long time. Here we're 2 minutes into the earthquake already, and the shaking continues and continues and continues. So this has now been a quantitative way of estimating what our susceptibility is to the next great earthquake in Southern California. My point is, besides showing you a pretty map, pretty image, is that 40 years of science, it took 40 years of science to actually get to where we would know that this is in fact the beast lurking beneath us and know quantitatively where our susceptibilities are. Another example that I actually worked on back when I was a graduate student, the Alaska pipeline was built to deliver 10 billion barrels of oil from the North Slope of Alaska down to the United States. And it was one of our ways of reducing our dependence on Middle Eastern oil, like the North Dakota shale gas fields are now. So here's the pipeline running across the countryside, and this happens to be a fairly well-built road, but there was an earthquake fault that ran through it in 2002 and shifted it about 2 meters. The question we had when we were looking at the faults that crossed the pipeline was, you know, we don't really think we want to have a big 48-inch, meter and a half diameter pipeline full of hot crude oil breaking and flowing out into the rivers of Alaska. So we wanted to make sure we protected that pipeline from fault rupture. Well, how do you do that? A pipeline is fairly stiff metal. How do you do that? Well, when we specified that, in fact, the last few earthquakes on that fault had caused a rupture of about 10 meters, they decided they'd figure out how to design a pipeline to resist that if it, in fact, it happened. Now, that only happens every few hundred years. But the risk, the political risk and the environmental risk was so great that the American government refused to allow this pipeline to be built unless they built to account for the possibility of a big offset. So what the engineers did, well, they're so clever, they built this snaky-like pipeline and they put it on Teflon railroad ties. So Teflon I-beams, so that these little guys would just slide. So when the fault rupture occurred, it would just slide on the beams and stretch. So there's where the fault is, and here's what it looks like when you get closer. Here's the I-beam. This used to be sitting over here, and it moved within about 1 meter of the edge. So there was almost an environmental disaster. In fact, my boss at the time said, we're not going to design for 10 meters. We're going to design for 8. And I said, oh, my God. I was 23 years old at the time, and I thought, oh, my God, that's you're really risking an environmental disaster. You should design for 11. And the young guy being more conservative than the older guy, but the older guy being wiser than the young guy, he gambled and he won. So there was no break in the pipeline, and in fact, the slider system worked. So that's what you can do when you apply science and when you want to ensure safety and so on. All right, so there's what actually happened. All right, let me talk about something that I'm not an expert about, so you can discount what I have to say if you'd like, but I'm gonna talk about sea level a little bit, and I'm gonna talk about it because Singapore has an issue with sea level. And the magnitude of the issue depends on how long you want to prepare Singapore for. So here's the IPCC 2013 report. So we're already a few years past that. As is usually the case with all five of the IPCC reports, usually what has actually happened is in the upper bound of their error. So currently, just within the last couple of years, there's become more and more of a consensus that the average here is not likely to be the rise in sea level, but in fact, this extreme. So people are now talking about evidence that the instability of West Antarctica and so on and so forth are likely to mean at least 1 meter, plus or minus some uncertainty, by 2100, so within 85 years. All right. Now, if you were to equilibrate the atmosphere, the current amount of CO2, with the oceans, other scientists, other modelers, climate modelers say that if you were to equilibrate the oceans, they would heat up enough to melt about 12 meters of ice. So if we just stayed where we are right now with regard to CO2, there would be a 12 meter sea level rise just to get to equilibrium. I'll show you later what that might mean for Singapore. All right, so in my lifetime, I started off over here before the 1957 beginning of measurements of CO2 at Mauna Loa or Mauna Kea in Hawaii. You can see the annual cycle here, 0.3 ppm per year through the 70s, 1.5 ppm per year through the 90s, 3.3 ppm per year on average currently, and this is known to be the driver. This and CO2 equivalent gases are known to be the driver for changing for increases in atmospheric temperature and ocean temperatures. Here's the last few years. We've been talking more and more about climate change. You can hardly open the New York Times today or the Straits Times and not see an article about some aspect of climate change. And here's what the effect has been of our having all this increased awareness of climate change. Nothing. Absolutely nothing. Peak was 397 ppm in 2012. 400, 2013, 402, 404, and this year it was a little higher than the average of 3. This year it actually jumped by 4. So that, in fact, when the scientist looks at it, doesn't really matter what's happening politically, socially, economically, greening of the world. In fact, we're on the same trend we've been on for the last 15, 20 years. Same rate. Now, there was a very interesting article in New York Times a few months ago that I actually, was just obviously very, very well done. And what they talked about was the effect of sea level change, even with just 20 centimeters of change in the last half century or so. And what they talked about was nuisance flooding. So here, for example, in Wellington, North Carolina, Here's the incidence of nuisance flooding. Nuisance flooding is where the extreme tides are high enough that, in fact, water comes bubbling out of the sewer or backs up into your lawn and kills the grass or floods your street for a few hours a day. So nuisance flooding in Wilmington, North Carolina was basically non-existent when I was born. It was almost non-existent, only 10 times a year in 1973. But then in the last 20 years, look what's happened. There are now 80 days in Wilmington, North Carolina of nuisance flooding. And that's only with sea level rising on the order of 20, 30 centimeters in the last couple of decades. Down here in Charleston, it's not quite so bad. They used to have zero, now they only have 40. So only one day in 10. So basically every high tide now, every monthly high tide plus a few, causes nuisance flooding in Charleston, South Carolina. Going a little further south, here's a place I actually went to this little place called Tybee Island this summer. And when I drove across this little street, I thought, boy, you know, this is awfully close to the tidal zone. And sure enough, this floods now about every month during the highest tide. So Tybee Island actually is cut off from the mainland about once a month. And Fort Pulaski is where that is. So here we go. Two and a half times every month now it's cut off. All right, now, the interesting part, the written part of this article was the most fascinating part, besides this wonderful graphic, because it talked about how even Republican mayors and governors are now saying, whoa, I don't believe in climate change, but you know what? My city sure is flooding a lot more than it used to. And I'm wondering if you'd be interested, Washington, federal government, in helping us pay for the problem. Okay, so this is the nature of American politics. We don't believe in facts unless we can walk through the water with our feet, and then we ask for a bailout. So my point here is that even the very initial parts of sea level rise are starting to have a $100 billion effect on the American economy. So I asked my class of 300 students at NTU last quarter this question. So for those of you who are from NTU, let's see if you guess the right answer. For those of you who aren't, my apologies. How much of NTU would be underwater if both of the ice sheets, the Greenland and the Antarctic ice sheet, melted? Inderjit, what do you think? Would it be just the entrances at Jalan Bahar and Pioneer Roads? Would it be South Spine but not North Spine? Would it be all but the highest buildings, or would it be the entire campus, including the buildings? Number two, okay, South Spine, but not North Spine. Let's see, Charlie, what do you think?
You show it in a little bit.
No, yeah, I am, but I showed you earlier, but you didn't look well enough. Okay, Kristen, what do you think?
Number three,
all but the highest buildings. Okay, well, if both of the big ice sheets melted, there'd be 67 meters of sea level rise, okay? When the big ice sheets in the Pleistocene melted, there was 130 meters. So we did two-thirds of it back around 20,000 to 10,000 years ago, and we would be doing another third of it when, in fact, the rest of the ice sheets melt. So, Kristen, you're right, actually. All but the highest buildings. So let me just show you. Here we are at 20 meters. Okay, here's the military training area. Here's the campus. Here's NIE. Here's, where is it? That's South Spine. There's North Spine. And there's 20 meters. So even at 20 meters, you'd be taking a boat to campus from any place else. Okay, there's 30. There's 40. There's 50. And there's 60. The only thing left at 60 is the student activity center up here and the what used to be the nursery and then the water storage. Okay, but the buildings would still be above the water, so you'd still be able to walk on the top stories. And there's 67. All right, let me ask the same question now. How much of Singapore would be underwater if you melted all the ice? How much would you have left? Remember what I said earlier, that even if you would just equilibrate the atmosphere today with its amount of CO2 with the marine realm, that'll take a while, a few hundred years, but if you did that, you would have 12 meters of sea level rise. Okay, so one of you Singaporeans I didn't call him before. What do you think Singapore would look like with 10 meters of sea level rise? What percentage do you think of Singapore would be gone? We have 700 square kilometers now. How many hundred square kilometers will we have left if there's 10 meters of sea level rise?
One third.
Okay, that's not a bad guess. There's 10 meters. Okay, so basically Singapore is then basically looking more like Batam and the islands of the south, right? It's several islands. Here, there's NTU Island over here. There's Bukit Timah Island here. There's NUS Island here. Okay, so that's 10 meters. Changi, no longer around. Or you'd have to have 777s with pontoons. Okay, there's 20 meters. Now, if I had to guess, I would guess that 20 meters is probably something like 200 years, 300 years in the offing for Singapore. Now, 200 years sounds like a long time, but 200 years is all that separates me from Thomas Jefferson, and all that separates you from another Thomas. Raffles, yeah? So, is Singapore going to think about this problem at this scale, or is it going to think about it at this scale? I think this is more than the polders, right? This is going to require more than polders, I think. All right, so there's 30 meters. There's 40 meters. Bukit Timah Islets and the Singapore Safety Islets, or NTU Safety Islets here. And there's 50. And there's 67. Okay? Now, the way we're headed, this is where we'll be. The way we're headed, we will probably lose Antarctica and Greenland, but it might take 1,000 years, it might take 2,000 years, but this is where we're headed with our burning of fossil fuels. All right, so I'm getting closer to the end here. To move our cultures to plan for and to promote resilience to infrequent geohazards, we need to keep our science in the public eye. I just want to make a pitch for keeping science in the public eye. We have to basically fund a lot of it, so that we know what the unknown, so the unknown unknowns become knowns. Think about this. What if we hadn't had a NASA? What if we hadn't had a NOAA? What if we hadn't had research on climate over the last 50 years? What if the guy had never put his, what if Charles Keeling had never put his little discovery-based, his little curiosity experiment on Mauna Loa and started measuring CO2? What if we had just gone without science into the climate future? We wouldn't know why this was happening. Nor would we be able to make projections as to what's happening or what's likely to happen. So continuing to fund a lot of science, continuing to fund a lot of discovery-based science, not just practical stuff, is very, very important if our civilization is going to have a soft landing when it comes to all of these very low likelihood but very high impact events. We need to respond publicly when there are events that catch the public's eye. And I want to just give you a couple of examples now of what we're doing in the observatory toward this. One from our community engagement office and the one from our applied projects group. So you may remember there was an earthquake in New Zealand a couple of days ago, or a couple of weeks ago. Very interesting for those of us who are earthquake geeks. What we did immediately was, even though we weren't involved in the research, we basically put together something for our website so that Singaporeans and anybody who's keyed into us can actually look and see within a few hours what in fact happened. And what in fact happened was the rupture of a little piece of the plate boundary that runs right through New Zealand. And in fact, we started putting together information that other scientists around the world were gathering from satellite data, you know, what went down, what went up, what faults broke. We actually crowdsourced this information. There are a lot of tourists and people taking pictures, and we said, whoa, they took a picture of an earthquake fault. And so in one case, the fault slipped about 10 meters sideways, like this. So we put all that together, and that's all up on our website, and we're hoping to keep interest going among school children, among teachers, among the average citizen here and elsewhere in Southeast Asia about earthquakes. So they learn what they're about, what their effects are, and so on. So we're trying to keep earth science up in the public eye. We have a website that has a blog, has news as it happens. And here's just an example I took from a couple of days ago. So that's one thing I'm very happy that Singapore has given us the opportunity to create a platform like this that'll be of use to not only Singapore, and not only just for learning reasons, but for actually responding to these hazards. As culture learns that these are possible, it's much more likely it will build into our cultures the desire to respond to them in a rational way. Peter, I was very encouraged to hear you say in your talk that Singapore aspires to be a leader in Southeast Asia, and I was also not surprised to hear you say that once you step offshore, it's very hard. It's much harder to be a leader because people have different priorities in different parts of the world. So Bangladesh might not have as much of an interest in taking care of its earthquake hazard because it has so many other issues to take care of. But anyway, I would love to have Singapore be the hub for responding to various natural hazards in the region. We have a project in Phuket right now that's a small little project, but basically after the tsunami, you know, they lost about 6,000 people in Phuket and nearby, and afterwards we started thinking, well, what can we learn about the tsunami hazard, the earthquake hazard, the other geohazards that exist around Phuket, which is a big tourist destination, and we've come up with local stakeholders, government stakeholders, businesses there, we've come up with a three-pillared program to basically have a smart disaster information system that tells the local people there in that province what can happen, what the probabilities are, create a not-for-profit enterprise that actually raises money through tourism to actually fund greater resilience, slowly but surely over the years, and then actually create a disaster resilience fund so that when there is a disaster, in fact, local businesses and individuals have funds to actually build back better. I'm going to go through this pretty fast. We have a lot of people we're working with in Thailand. Here's how we're doing it. Here's what some of the scenarios look like. There's not just a tsunami hazard. There's also an earthquake hazard that's largely unappreciated. And we want to build this pyramid. State-of-the-art understanding of hazards and risks, response plans that are effective, adequate resources to respond, financial resilience mechanism for swift recovery after an event, and then finally, minimizing the risk for everyone economically, personally, and so on. So I tried to cover this in the hour or so. I hope I'm very happy to be an Earthling. I'm glad I'm not on Mars. I think you guys are much more interesting to me, being Earthlings, having to worry about traffic problems and being safe in traffic and safe in earthquakes and hurricanes and volcanic eruptions and so on. It's a marvelous planet, but it's a very dangerous one. It's like the femme fatale, right? Very beautiful, but be careful. Thank you.
Other questions?
Thank you very much for your talk. And you mentioned IPCC reports that are very, I think, every 5 years, if I'm not wrong. Mm-hmm. And IPCC is a top-bottom approach, right? So basically, the scientist community is approaching policymakers in order to deliver the state-of-the-art research about the all different types of results that they got. But I'm wondering whether you think that also the bottom-up approach, meaning that the awareness among the communities and societies would be also very helpful, if not more helpful. I mean, basically sharing the knowledge and the data which you just shared with us, we say in schools, and universities on a much broader scale that we are doing now would be more useful because then the citizens will be probably more responsible for the future that is coming and also will be more demanding for the policies to come from the politicians. And if you're aware of something like this, it will be very interesting to listen. Thank you.
Actually, I think you're mistaken in saying it's top-down, the IPCC. It's actually quite bottom-up. It starts with scientists actually bringing in data, putting it together, running a whole variety of models, different institutes running models, and then doing averages of models. And then eventually you have, there's like five different phases, the scientific phase, the data phase, the modeling phase, and then only toward the end does it actually get into the hands of the policymakers, who then usually make it a little bit less dangerous sounding, which I think is probably why we tend to end up being on the top part of the uncertainty curve in every single case, because it gets the eventual IPCC's documents actually for policy are actually somewhat toned down so as not to scare people as much. But I think over the last 10 years, we've seen what you've been talking about. There's just a huge amount of public involvement now in climate issues. And those two slides I showed from the New York Times were very, to me, the best example of that I've seen, that people are now seeing their places, their communities flooding or having sea level rise issues. They're now thinking, how are we going to solve this problem? There was an article last week in the New York Times or Washington Post about how Floridans are now worrying about property prices on the coast. And in fact, property prices have not gone up since 2008 on the coast in Florida, but they've gone up 16% in the interior. So I think it's slowly happening, but you might remember that the guy who led the IPCC in 2007, the Indian fellow, what was his name? Pachauri, he said, look, this is in 2007, we don't do something by 2012 to cut down on the atmospheric, the input of CO2 equivalents to the atmosphere by 2012, we're toast. Well, it's now 2016. And a lot of us who are fairly close to this issue feel that we're probably pretty close to toast. We probably don't have much latitude to do much anymore. I guess I'm not sure that's answering your question, but I think there is an awful lot of public interest now and public involvement and public offering of data, what they see happening. Huh? But it's still primarily got to come out of the scientific community making scientific measurements.
Gary, you didn't mention about the explosion that created Lake Toba, number one. Number two, with regard to the Canary Islands, that the eastern frontier of America is at risk. And it's a matter of time that, you know, the explosion will happen. So these two points, if you could clarify. Thanks a lot.
Well, I actually didn't mention Toba, but Toba is an interesting example. Toba is the biggest volcano on Earth, and it formed the 100-kilometer diameter Lake Toba that's such a wonderful tourist destination. There has been speculation that Toba actually influenced human evolution. And that it influenced the creation of the last ice age, but the timing doesn't quite work out right. So that's never really been nailed down. It's still considered a speculation. You're right, the Canary Islands are very much like the Hawaiian Islands, and the Canary Islands also have these huge sector collapses into the ocean. The same guy that did that model I showed did some for the Canary Islands as well, and you have 500-meter high tsunamis on the east coast, the west coast of Africa nearest. But then by the time you get to New York and to Miami, they're 10 meters high. 10 meters in Miami is a big number, right? But I raise the question again to you, you know, is it just silly to worry about these things? I mean, these things happen, you know, once every tens of thousands of years. And it's not an easy question to answer whether you should worry about such things.
Thank you for the fascinating sharing. Are there any man-made incidents that can accelerate the melting of an ice sheet, say, for example, a nuclear incident that could affect the climate and accelerate the melting of ice sheets, and then that would subsequently flood even more cities and possibly Singapore? I mean, just a possible scenario. That's the first question. And the second question would be, it's said that animals tend to have a certain capability to sense tsunamis or natural disasters. So are there scientists studying the behavior of animals and whether that can be a way of anticipating possible tsunamis, earthquakes, or geographical dangers?
Okay, the first question. There are a lot of scientists right now working on what could actually affect the melting of the West Antarctic ice sheet in particular. Many recent papers have come out saying that you know, it could be faster, it could be slower. There's no doubt that what's happening now is anthropogenic, that it's happening because of our putting the CO2 in the atmosphere and that going into the oceans, right? I don't think there's any consensus right now as to
what we could do that would actually cause, a tipping point where we'd actually just melt so much faster, right? But there clearly are going to be tipping points where, for example, one of the issues with the ice sheets that are floating out over the ocean in Antarctica off the West Antarctic ice sheet, many of those are resting on ridges of debris that they've dumped earlier. And if they melt back past that, which some of them are beginning to do, and some in Alaska have already done, then they could retreat much more rapidly, and they could cause much more quick, rapid flow into the ocean, much more rapid creation of icebergs and melting and so on. So a lot of climate scientists, a lot of glaciologists are profoundly worried about the possibility of accelerating melting of the ice, right? But the consensus still is that by 2100, there's probably going to be on the order of a meter higher sea level, plus or minus 30 centimeters or so. Beyond that, it depends on whether you tend toward the dramatic or toward the conservative, whether it's going to be 5 meters by 200 years or 3 meters by 200 years. With regard to animals being able to sense earthquakes and tsunamis, the most reasonable speculations are that they can sense the P wave on the earthquake, that they can sense the first fastest waves arriving much better than people can, and that may be why, for example, elephants stampeded in Thailand before the 2004 tsunami hit. We just aren't sensitive enough to feel it. Back in the 70s, when the earthquake happened in northern China, in Heilongjiang province, there were apparently snakes that came crawling out of the ground before the earthquake hit, and same thing with Tangshan, and people didn't feel it, so people in Tangshan died, right? But that's never been marshaled to any use. All right, so not much going on in research in that regard right now.
Thank you very much for the talk. First, you said in the start and in the conclusion that people deal well with frequent hazard, right? And you provided good examples, I think, but also, we see in many countries in the area, so Southeast Asia and South Asia, that some events are actually recurrent and are not well dealt with. I'm thinking here, for example, of floods in Nepal, northern India, and they wreak havoc every year, so we have like thousands of deaths every year. And so I would like to know what you think about which mitigation measures you believe are to be a priority to deal with those recurrent events that for now are not dealt with. And in particular, I'm interested to know what you think about trying to mitigate those geohazards by introducing insurance, either by the private sector or by PPP. In those countries where insurances might not actually be a good thing?
I think you've hit on a really important way of dealing with hazards, insurance. When I first came here, one reason I came to Singapore to work on geohazards was because so little was known in the entire region. In the 2004 tsunami was a total unknown, an unknown unknown. Nobody, even among scientists, thought it could happen. And when I first got here, I thought, you know, with as I saw local farmers, say, on the flanks of a volcano, losing their livelihoods in the course of one eruption, or in the Philippines, or a flood from a typhoon in the Philippines wiping out an entire village, I thought, couldn't we form a trust from all ASEAN nations, where a farmer pays a penny a year, or a businessman pays $1,000 a year, and you create a trust which is managed by people you really trust, like Lee Kuan Yew or someone else that is other people who are very trusted in the region. And whenever a disaster hit, you would actually have payouts to those farmers to purchase other land. Or if your land subsides in Jakarta and you have to move inland, you can't afford it. Or if your land is carried away by the migration of a river in Bangladesh, there's no place to go because it's already populated back behind you. So if in fact there were a trust fund that would pay out to those who paid their penny or who paid their $1,000 a year, it might be a way to mitigate the effects of all these hazards. That probably is hard enough when you have a stable hazard environment where the averages are the same from year to year. But you mentioned flooding. Flooding and drought actually are increasing now in frequency, and they're increasing as a result of climate change. How do you actually know how to set premiums when you don't, when you can't use the past as a measure of what will happen in the future? So rather than answering your question very well, I'll just say that I think that climate change in particular is making it extraordinarily difficult to know how to respond to these increasing extreme events. And I can barely keep track of my own finances. I don't think I could handle all of Southeast Asia, so I would defer to the successful businessmen and financial folks here in the audience.
Hi, David Lalemant from Stanford University, and very soon from NTU. Thank you, Kerry, for this really interesting presentation. I really like the anecdote about the pipeline, where you had said it should be built for 10 meter offset, and the decision was to make it 8, and you said, and he was proven right. And this idea of proven right, I think, is really interesting, because it could have been otherwise. And I think that's one of the main problems we're facing when you talk about these low probability events of how do we start incentivizing correct decision making regardless of outcome? And I use the city that I've been living in, San Francisco, as an example. San Francisco and the scientists in San Francisco had worked for decades in order to build evidence for a retrofit scheme for the most vulnerable buildings. And the new mayor came in and said, an earthquake will not happen in my tenure, so I will not fund this. And he was right. No earthquake happened in his tenure. So do you have ideas for how we can address this problem of rewarding people who do make...
Elect a different mayor.
Yeah. Yeah, how do we reward people for making right decisions even if the outcome are not felt in their tenure and vice versa?
Here's the kind of argument I would make to that mayor or to somebody else who is disinclined to deal with long-term, low likelihood events. When I look around this room, everything I see is a product of civilization. I mean, everything, right? Except maybe my skin. Okay, I mean, and that's genetic. That's something from hundreds of thousands of years ago. But my coat, my jacket, my presentation materials, my paper, my microphone, my glasses, everything comes out of civilization. I love civilization. I really hold it dear. I'm glad I don't live 100 years ago, because, in fact, if I had, I'd be dead. I would have had two infections that would have killed me when I was 40 or 32 and 58. Okay? So I'd be dead 100 years ago. I really value the complexity of my society, my civilization, and I want to do whatever I can to protect it so that it can even, so that human progress can continue at this sort of, in this sort of a trajectory rather than like this. And I'm afraid that when people make short-term decisions about very consequential events that may or may not happen, that might have a 1% chance in 500 years, when they make decisions not to deal with that, they threaten the very existence of all we hold dear. Now, that may not be true if you live on an island offshore Sumatra where you're basically living in the Stone Age now. You'll make it, you'll be about the same, but it will have a profound effect upon us in Singapore, a profound effect on San Francisco, if in fact there's a long-term attitude about earthquakes in San Francisco or about climate change along the East Coast of the United States of, I just can't worry about this. I've got mouths to feed, money to make. So that's all I can do is try to convince people that, in fact, their civilization is really worth preserving and giving the opportunity for that civilization to become even more interesting and more vital. And I don't think we've reached 80% of what humanity has to offer yet, and I'd just soon see that remaining 20% or have my kids see it.
Really, Kerry, I just want you to repeat that. It seems to me that the core issue we have here is that there is a very, very large black elephant, and that black elephant is presentism. And that black elephant is based on a very real business which you just described. Most people's lives are extremely immediate. They just have to deal with stuff now. And any number of the people who work for us as members of governments likewise have an obligation to deal with now. They've got to make sure that roads work, traffic accidents are mitigated, and so on. And my sense of dealing with a lot of the people who do these kinds of things is that this completely fills their brain. What is worrying is that in my own university, we've just established two regional studies centers, one for China and one for Southeast Asia. Both have a completely presentist agenda. And one of the reasons for that is that universities are having to focus on a now in which they can make themselves visible and profitable. So the very agencies which we would expect to facilitate a longer view are in fact in an economic and financial situation where they can no longer safely afford to do it. Which suggests to me that we have to start looking somewhere else in our cultural world for agencies which will do something of this sort. Will the Institutes of Advanced Study, for instance, help to do something of this sort? How do you think we might try to tackle this problem? Because our great agency of thinking, the universities, does do the thinking. I've been allowed to do pretty much what I wanted to do for 50 years. The problem is getting it to lock out.
Thank you for that uplifting prognosis. I despair more often than I get excited at the prospects, frankly. The election, most recent election in the United States did not help me despair less. I'm out of the Western tradition, right? The Western tradition, the Greek tradition, is the heroic tradition. And even though the hero knew he wasn't likely to make it through the battle, he was sure going to still try to do whatever he heroically could. And so I am not going to just throw in the towel and say, America, you can have yourselves. I'm going to do whatever I can to try to make a difference and to try to make an enlightened difference. And academics have the privilege of spending almost all their lives, when they're not teaching students, they spend almost all their lives just trying to understand how the world works. And so that privilege allows us the time to talk and to share our thoughts about things like I've been doing here. If I were a consultant, I wouldn't have the time. I'd have to go out and find the next dime, find the next project, right? Frankly, I think it's relatively hopeless, but I'm not going to give up. I gave this lecture, my last lecture in my class to the 300 students or so, and afterwards I was so depressed because I gave them such a negative message. You know, I had two slides of the earth like this, and I said, thank you for taking this journey, this wonderful sojourn with me through the field that I, you know, of geohazards and figuring out how the world works. And then the next slide was the same picture of the earth, and it said, good luck in making your way through the Anthropocene. And I walked out feeling maybe I had done a disservice to them, to discourage them. But as I was saying to, it wasn't Peter, I was saying it to somebody else here before the meeting, facts are stubborn things, right? John Adams, when he was defending one of the soldiers involved in the Boston Massacre, was talking to his opponent in the court, and the opponent was saying something that was unfactual. And he said, you know, I'm on the right side of this argument. Facts are stubborn things. Facts in the end are going to win. So you better look at the facts and then behave accordingly. So that's our strongest argument, I guess.
At the deep risk of being repetitive, I just want to build on the last two because I think that in a certain sense lies at the core of conferences like this. I agree that facts are stubborn, and I agree that rationality is the only intelligent approach that one can bring to bear in respect of this. But I think sometimes we've got to grapple with the reality that we're not communicating insights out of research in ways that translate into effective policy. And it's easy to say policymakers are stupid and they don't understand the issues and there are other pressures on them. And, you know, we can come up with all sorts of wonderful excuses. The real question is whether or not those of us who try to communicate facts in ways that are intended to have an impact on human behavior are able to communicate effectively in what we do. And two of the examples that I guess we've just heard off the back of what I thought was an absolutely splendid presentation, Kerry, make that point for me rather sharply. The one goes to insurance. One of the most perverse consequences of insurance has actually been causing larger and larger amounts of property development in hazard-prone areas, particularly in coastal locations. Because as a result of the fact that you could get property insurance, it then became possible to monetize development in areas in which it would have been completely inconceivable to have done earlier because you could never put the funding together to enable the package. One of the consequences of that is Wharton's Risk and Decision Making Center has shown graphically now over about 7 or 8 years is that the amount of payouts as a consequence of natural disasters in coastal areas in the United States has increased exponentially. A significant part of that is due to the fact that we have enabled that sort of behavior through a variety of financial instruments. And had we been more intelligent in respect to the way in which we dealt with it, we wouldn't have done that. The second thing lies in the question about data analytics and the opportunity for both predictive and preventive analysis in that particular regard, because I thought you showed rather splendidly that the low probability incident with high impact depends on how you measure it. It depends on the scale over which you undertake the measurement. In the first instance, your 10% versus 11% illustration made the point rather splendidly. And I sometimes wonder if we're good enough at developing the sort of granularity that would inform decisions about appropriate policies as effectively as we can.
Let me pick up on that last point. I think that's very important. I think the answer is largely no. The hazards community, the people that actually work on how the world works and figure out where the hazards are, where they can be, what the probabilities are, whether there's conditional probabilities involved, we have a long ways to go to get the insurance companies, to get the governments to have the data they need to really price premiums properly. There's no doubt about that. But everything I told you today is 40 years worth of science. So we know worlds more now than in all of these areas, climate, sea level, earthquakes, volcanoes, than we knew when I started out as in grad school. Huh? So huge progress has been made. One of the reasons I said that we need to keep funding more and more and more of this is so that our insurers and the people who actually do take the financial risks and try to spread out the exposure to losses know exactly what they're doing. There was an article just last week in the Washington Post that said that in Florida now, it is becoming hard to get to buy homes in the coast because the the people giving the mortgages, the banks, are loath to do it anymore because they now, because the premiums are so high because of the for flooding. So I think insurance is a natural way within our culture to basically say, this is a little bit risky for me. I'm not going to insure this. If I'm not going to insure this, the bank's not going to give you a mortgage. So I think that's probably what we're going to continue to see in Florida and on the eastern seaboard. Don't you think?
Yes, and no. Fashion dictates what happens. And if you take what happened around the whole issue of terrorism reinsurance, you've got quite a splendid illustration of this. In the immediate aftermath of 9/11, by definition, it would have been impossible to secure all sorts of insurance against that sort of risk. Congress stepped in. Congress passed a particular piece of legislation, which in fact required the allocation of government money for that particular purpose, clearly necessary for a whole variety of other reasons. But it's the sort of thing that happens for political reasons in circumstances when the market works in a different direction. The other part of the problem is that sometimes the market response to these particular issues is not by any stretch of the imagination adequately informed by an understanding of the longer term consequences of this, because it is short-termist by definition. So it's really squaring all of these complicated circles simultaneously that I think provides the biggest challenge.
I think you're right, going back to your previous comment, I think you're right that we have a long way to go to effectively get our information out to it where it matters. But I have to say that in 8 years in Singapore here, listening to leaders like Peter, it's been inspiring as an American coming from a place where I think I spent 15 minutes of my entire life with a congressman. So I think Singapore can play, definitely is going to play an outsized role in solving these problems in Southeast Asia.
Thank you, Jan, thank you. Kerry, you didn't mention one thing about it. If you pointed out the severity of the consequence of the the climate change situation, why is it that countries like Singapore, Seychelles, and the others are not making it a special appeal that the 2% target is way out? Why is it that you are not asking for more? I remember my learned friend from Straits Time, before Straits Time, then he moved to Shell, when I said that, look, Shell, the green LNG, you people are not initiating. The Baltic countries, for example, are not initiating seriously. And the question is that the unthinkable damage done to the North Pole is unthinkable. So the question is that, are we making a serious effort to say that the 2%, it's hardly enough? I suggested last time 5%, they say it's not possible. So the question is that, are we not putting it, you know, kind of contingency request that, you know, it be, you know, be considered seriously that the higher target should be?
Look, yeah. Pete, my president-elect has just decided he's going to disengage from Paris, right? Okay. You're talking about 5%. I mean, I'm not a politician, but it seems to me that the writing is on the wall that it's going to be hard to even get what's inadequate done, right? So I don't know, maybe Peter or Indrajit would like to answer that on behalf of Singapore, why we're not pushing for more, but I suspect the reason is it's hard to even push for what we've been pushing for.
All right. Let's thank Kerry again.